Good afternoon, good members. We now had a quorum at the scheduled time. We shall now elect a chairman. Well, this is the Subcommittee on 7 pieces of subsidiary legislation relating to the implementation of the new inspection regime of the company's register under the company ordinance. According to the rules of procedure, and we now accept nominations. An effective nomination must be made orally by one member and seconded by an unnominated member and accepted by the nominated member, him or herself. Any nominations? Mr. Holden Chow. I nominate Mr. Chen Ying. Any seconders? I see quite a few seconders there. Mr. Chen, would you accept the nomination? Yes. Any other nominations? I declare Mr. Chen Chenying elected ipso facto as the chairman of this subcommittee. Please come over to the podium. And he shall now preside over the meeting. May I ask members, do we need to elect a deputy chairman as well? You don't see as necessary. Let's go straight to the next item, meeting with the administration. May I first invite the administration team into the room, please? Attending today's meeting from the administration, Mr. Sam Hui, Deputy Secretary for Financial Services and Treasury, Financial Services Special Duties, Mr. Desmond Wu, PAS for Financial Services and the Treasury, Ms. Kitty Choi, Acting Registrar of Company, Ms. Ellen Chen, Deputy Principal Solicitor, Company Law Reform of Company Registry, Ms. Mariana Yu, Registry Manager, Company's Registry, Mr. Jonathan Look, Senior Government Counsel from the DOJ. Can the administration walk us through the discussion paper? Mr. Hui, please. Good afternoon, members. Today we're tabling to let go a very piece of subsidiary legislation to implement the new inspection regime from the latest round of amendments of the company's ordinance. And in terms of the level openness and the level of privacy protection, we hope to strike a delicate balance. Within the company ordinance, the relevant provisions has been provided that inside the company registry, the personal particulars of the directors should be protected, two pieces of which. First, the usual residential addresses, URA, in the future, it could be replaced by a corresponding address. And second, the full identification numbers of a company director. Currently, the full IDN will become a partial IDN. After the implementation, the public can continue to access director-related particulars in the company registry. For the sensitive personal particulars, will only be available in special situations in order to afford greater protection for privacy. Altogether, we have 7 pieces of subsidiary legislation tabled to let go. Why are there so many that after considering the implementation of the yet-to-be-enacted new provisions and for the system upgrade and the administrative procedures are quite cumbersome. The procedures will also take time to consolidate and for data conversion. After careful consideration of the system requirements and administrative procedures, we propose to enact the take a gradual approach to enact the yet to be enacted provisions within the CO. There will be 3 phases. At the first one, and from the 23rd of August 2021, the company's own register may replace that sensitive personal info with their correspondent addresses and replace their full IDNs of the directors with their partial IDNs for public inspection. For phase two, kick start from 24th October 2022. By then, the protected information containing documents filed for registration after commencement will be automatically masked. And for phase three, that will commence in the late 2023, that the protected information contained in documents already registered with CR before commencement of phase two will be replaced with corresponding addresses and partial IDNs. To tie in with the phased implementation, there will be six pieces of subsidiary legislation, three of which are commencement notices for the three phases. And the three other are the existing amendments to the existing provisions with the company ordinance. For the seventh piece of subsidiary legislation is a new regulation that under the new inspection regime, which are the specified persons can access the protected information from directors upon application. At the latest round of the amendments to the company ordinance, we have conducted extensive public consultation. And by then, for the data subject, the company members and the public bodies and the public officers, and for those who must access to directors in particulars due to their executive function, we will include them under the specified persons. Over the past 2 months, we discussed extensively with the stakeholders, and the currently tabled legislation, beside the class I mentioned, we also add a new category that wasn't included at the discussion 10 years ago, which included a practicing solicitor in a law firm, practicing accountant, banks, and under the anti-terrorism financing regime, for those who authorized institution with a duty to execute the AML and CTF duties. And we have now included them as specified person in the current version table to let's go. To ensure that the corporate governance framework, the necessary enforcement and statutory functions for the office holder continue to able to access them to do their job properly. Besides the contents of this legislation, in the course of discussion, we have also made some enhancement to the company registry system and procedures. In the future, the company directors that the full IDN will not be available for public inspection. First, we need to avoid that whether there were two persons with identical names and also sharing the same IDN. By administrative measure, we will provide an extra number to facilitate the public to telepath the two individuals. And for the second thing, the whether that you have the same person, however, they may show up with different patterns of the same name, which may confuse the public. If we're a director of the same company and we can, our system can tell that it is the same individual, even though they filed their name in different patterns, their particulars in the CR will be grouped under a single entry to facilitate public inspection and easy identification. With these two measures, even though the public may not have access to full IDN of the directors, however, to differentiate the same director or different directors in different companies, there wouldn't be not much difficulty. And this will also tie in with the phase implementation, especially phase two, to facilitate the public to continue to use the company register. And that's the end of my introduction. We're happy to take on any questions from members. Thank you, Mr. Hui. For this subcommittee, we have 12 members, and some of those who have yet to sign up also have their questions. I will allocate sufficient time. Well, already two want to speak. Let's say 5 minutes per round. First, Mr. Lok Chung Hong. Thank you, Chairman. Well, on the new inspection regime of the company's register, we understand it has to do with protection of data privacy to prevent weaponization of privacy and for doxing purposes. This proposed amendments make the resolution of labor dispute by trade unions, actually this will pose some inconvenience or trouble for the trade unions. In terms of drafting of the subsidiary legislation or the upcoming administrative measures, how do we make the greatest effort to help the staff to fight for their legitimate entitlements? One of the biggest aspirations from the FTU that for the labor unions on behalf of the workers filing a claim that in certain circumstances they can access less sensitive personal information like the residential addresses, for example. When dealing with the labor dispute in the past, well, some of the companies already wind down. Of course, the company has vanished. Therefore, you cannot get in touch with the company director or the person in charge. Very often, the PIC is a company director. In some cases, they may have provided outdated or invalid addresses like a secretary company. There's no way to reach them. Therefore, we need to contact the directors. As for what situation, very often we help the workers in the labor department mediation service. We need to issue a notice to the employer or the company director. And for the second stage, at the labor tribunal, we need to send a case letter to the proprietor or the company director, which requires an address. Therefore, we all along hoped, trade unions is a registered body under the trade union ordinance. Therefore, can the trade unions become a specified body or persons? The administration did not give us a positive reply and suggested we should appoint a lawyer instead. Well, a lawyer usually work in a commercial litigation. However, hiring a lawyer will incur extra costs on ordinary workers. Of course, I've been asking around for pro bono lawyers or for a nominal fees to do registry searching service to help our workers. I anticipated there will be just not many.
Also, secondly, now the government said that if the address is no longer valid, then the person interested can apply to company's registry to get other means of contact, including other addresses. So now, what clear guidelines do you have? Now, for instance, I sent a letter. The letter couldn't reach that person. Now, if I could demonstrate that, then the interested person, usually that's the worker, now, if he tackles that by administrative means, now how long before he can get the address for contacting the director from the administration? When we make the legislation, we discuss this with many stakeholders, including the unions, trade unions. Now, in our provisions on the specified persons, we take a cautious approach. Now, on the list of specified persons, now, apart from the data subject, now, there are those who have legal functions or who apply certain legal responsibilities. So those are on the list of specified persons. Now, for the trade unions or for worker organizations, now there's no corresponding legal responsibility or legal requirement that they must obtain the means of contact of the director, especially the director's address. So we haven't placed the trade unions on the list of specified persons, but we do understand that for workers in the course of labor dispute, very often the worker is in a more, is in a weaker position, and so this merits our concern. So we did some work. Now the Labor Department's mediation role is not affected by the search process. Now the mediating staff can be a specified person, and he can get the required information about the company if necessary. Now, if the director's address is no longer valid, his address in the register, then anyone, for various reasons, if he finds that the company director's declared means of contact on the register is invalid, he can always lodge the complaint with the company's registry, and the registry will follow up. And we talk to the company's registry. The usual procedure is that they will send a letter to the director concerned to find out whether the declared means of contact is valid, and usually 14 days is allowed for that. That's the usual administration procedure. Now, we have to make sure that the information on the register is valid and transparent, and we also have to let the person concerned be able to clarify. So in the process of checking whether the means of contact is valid, this is actually a process useful to the worker. Now, if the address is found to be invalid, now the Labor Department involved in the mediation process will take note, and the worker concerned can also bring this to the notice of the company's registry so that the checking process can start expeditiously. I believe this is helpful to the workers striving for their rights. There are four more members. Michael Tan, Holden Chow, Chiu Hua Feng, and Chen Kim Po. Lok Chung Hong can be on the second round. Anyone else who's interested can raise his hand. Michael Tan, 5 minutes. Now, what interests me most are two rather confusing concepts. Now, same person, different names, or same name, different persons. Now, someone is called Peter Chen, in Chinese, Chen Daiman. So in his, for his companies, he registers as Chen Daiman, and in also as Peter Chen. And then in third company, he registers as T.N. Chen. And the ID number is the same in all four cases. So we can't know whether these three are the same persons because partial ID numbers may be the same. So last time I requested that all companies, all directors in companies registers, they must use their full name in the ID. So the order must be the same. Now, if it's Peter Chen Tai Man, and if there are two persons with the same ID number, then that's the second issue. That's the same number, different persons. But I'm asking now about same person, different names. Now, and this, so there are persons, same person, different names in different companies. Now, I'm asking that the full name in the ID be used, and that will resolve all the difficulties. Is that going to be the practice? Now, the company's registry, now did ask that the companies in providing particulars of their directors to the company's registry should follow the ID arrangement. Now, so this has been there all along? Yes. This is the administrative arrangement, but the habit over the years is that as long as there's a certain clarity to identify the person, there is no assurance that the exact format or form is adhered to, the exact form in the ID is adhered to. So we propose two solutions. The company's registry will ask that the director's name will be identical to that on his ID. This will be strictly enforced. Now, if the name presented is different from that on his ID, the company's registry will ask the person to make amendment or to clarify. Now, if he doesn't heed the CR, if he doesn't clarify the information, and the information has to do with the reliability of the information on the company's registry, then he may have infringed the legislation. And there may be a fine on the director. So when you accept registration, why don't you just make sure that the ID number, ID name is fully used before you let him register? Yes, that's what we do. Now, if the personal information of the director is quite unclear, then the company's registry can set aside the registration process. So that means the CR doesn't let the company registered, then company will be unable to fulfill all the required procedures and there will be a penalty. So we do have legal administrative means to tackle the issue, but I'd like to explain to Mr. Tian that apart from the powers and penalties that we can draw on, now on the company's register, we also make a change to the system. Like Mr. Chen said, Mr. Tian said, for instance, Chen Tai Man for one company and Peter Chen for a different company and TM Chen on another company. But because we identify that these are the same person, so we organize the information under one as one piece of information to make sure that the information pertains to the same person. So for users, this would be helpful. So three names, different companies, and you group them together. But when you group them together, we don't know it's the same person. Now, after the name, we will indicate that he... we indicate that he registered under different names for different companies. So this enables the person to be identified. But why don't you just prevent him from registering? Why do you let that problem occur? It seems he has answered the question. Now, the information on the company's register, it's a very large body of information and there are historical discrepancies. So we will, over time, sort the data out and we will make sure that for the same person, he will be identified as that one person on the company's register. And his identity in different companies would be ascertained. So, the legacy matters will be resolved in the way the Deputy Secretary described. In the future, they will make sure that the exact procedure is followed for new registrations. Now, if we have more than one meeting, we hope that they will supply the information later. Next, Holden Chow, 5 minutes. Now, we must trace the matter to the origin. Now, this arrangement on company search is to prevent some people use the procedure for doxing and other bad conduct. So there is the need for this administrative arrangement. Now, I'd like to ask about some details in company search. If it's the same person, now there may be historical reasons, but different names were registered under different companies. Now, the administration did answer the question, in the future, when there is a company search, if it's the same person, using different names, for instance, Peter Chen, Chen Tai Man, TM Chen, then the company search will show all three names. Then that seems reasonable to me, and it can resolve the problem. Now, last time I asked a question, some people did use different names or initials when they registered as directors. So how to make sure we can tell the difference? Now, at the time, it was said that there would be a uniform arrangement to ask them to register in the full name on the ID. So there is an answer submitted today. Now, you're talking about the same person using different names to register. You group them together. So I believe when someone contacts conducts company search, everything will be found out. Now, you added the lawyers as specified persons. Now, in case there is a problem, like what we are talking about, the lawyers will be concerned. So your document makes this clear. This is the arrangement you're going to adopt. You make clear all the different names will be shown. I think this is quite necessary. Now, as for follow-up, I think that you have to draw a line. Now, after the new legislation is passed, I believe the company's registry will adopt the new procedures to make sure that the company directors follow the full name on the on their IDs when they register. So maybe in the past you didn't adopt this procedure strictly, you didn't follow the procedure strictly. In future, all new registrations should incorporate the full names on the IDs.
So that's my piece of opinion. So I would like to hear from the FSTB. Mr. Hui. Thank you, Mr. Chow. Mr. Chow's observation was accurate. And this is also our arrangements for the new inspection regime. And for any new documents filed, we stress that the name of the directors must match their ID. And for the next October, when we get to phase two, by then, we will be able to see the full IDN of the directors. And for the directors with the same full IDN, that all the directorships and the names will be grouped together for convenience of the users. And this will be a very good way for the lawyers to tell the way the same person while performing their due diligence. And this will be implemented. If no other follow-up, then Mr. Christopher Chung. We're glad to see the government took heed of the advice of the financial service industry by specifying the securities firm and other recognized financial institutions to able to access to the sensitive personal information. I will not repeat the question of other members before me. I have two simple questions. While inspecting the register, you would first need to confirm the identity of the specified persons. I wonder how long will this take, and it is complicated. Well, for a customer who would like to open an account, they probably wouldn't want to wait for too long. Thus, how long can the specified information can wait to gain access? For the unscrupulous persons, they may use some specified persons to inspect the register and provide them to the loan collection companies. How can you avoid this from happening? A very practical issue. Mr. Hui? The first question by Mr. Cheng on the application procedure. This is an administrative procedure. And currently, the classes within the specified persons beside the data subject or a person authorized by the data subject. For all other categories, either the public officers or those the bodies or individual who keep registers. As for the MLCTF ordinances, whose some individuals or bodies who were governed by them, and these organization or bodies will have access to such data. Mr. Cheng, please be assured that it will be too long. We'll try to take a simple way to facilitate inspection for specified persons. For those that need to perform inspection from time to time and to conduct due diligence as their statutory functions, they do not need to apply for access every time. They just have to confirm their registered identity and also their professional qualifications. After validating it by the CR, the CR will provide an authorized account for the individual. Then this person will conduct an inspection using that account instead of applying every time. For the specified persons, let's say that person to do a lot of inspections every day. Well, he will need to engage others to do the inspection on his or her behalf. Is there anyone in the government to supervise or oversee this arrangement? That's the second question by Mr. Cheng. And all the regulations on specific persons, we made it very clearly, like besides belong to the category, there will actually be conditions. As for the securities firm, the condition is that the inspection must comply with requirements under the ATM CTF regime. For the before an inspection, they need to make a confirmation on the purpose of inspection. If the client they serve is unrelated to the purpose of the claim in inspection, that will be guilty of a false oath. If the information passed on to an unrelated third party, which led to abuse or misuse, the data source will have criminal and civil liability. That this specified person inspection records will be stored for the law enforcement agencies and the police to investigate cases of data misuse. And I take this opportunity to remind these specified persons and bodies, even though they will have the right to conduct inspection, however, they do need to follow observe the obligations to properly handle the personal particulars. Next, Mr. Paul Chan. The brief mentioned and the this arrangement was first proposed in 2012. After much discussion, this regime have yet to be enacted. The UK enacted this new arrangement at the same time. This shows the government is disrespecting data privacy. The PDBO has written to the subcommittee in support of the new regime. Of course, you need to make adjustments to certain requirements. However, you should not deviate from the original perspective. If you expanded it so much as if the law has never been amended, what's the point? Of course, I need to see amendments necessary, for example, including trade unions for chasing default wages. I will support this. And any kind of controversies have yet to be addressed yet? For example, the trade unions, and a lot of people see these are worthy of including them. Any other recommendations that's not adopted? For the information that's been going viral online, this is probably beyond your scope. Is there any way that you can conceal the information that have been circulating already? Thank you, Mr. Chan's question. In our discussion with stakeholders, besides with the trade unions, one sector expressed strong desire to be included as a specified person. That is the press and the journalists. We listened to their demands and met with them and discussed with them. And we also made a lot of exchanges on the context of public interest. Our consideration is the same in my reply to Mr. Lok at the beginning of this meeting. We understand as to deliver quality reporting, access to personal information will help with the investigative reporting. However, this is not prescribed by any law or an obligation conferred by legislation. While lacking a legal basis, in order to do the work to enhance public transparency, which may lead to easy access of personal information, we set that at risky. It would not get it right. A lot of the NGOs and bodies who promote certain interests of certain social groups may request access to the sensitive information of directors on similar grounds. We don't agree that this is a good balance. That's why that we are holding the line that the specified person either need to carry out their statutory functions or they have been conferred and imposed a duty by law which they need access to the director's information to execute their functions. Well, after weighing in so much pros and cons, we see that the current arrangement is the most reasonable. And that's my response to the first part of Mr. Chan's question. The second question may not have to do with the new inspection regime. Besides the company registered containing the official information, I know that in the private marketplace, some organization or individuals may post the personal information online or for profit-making purposes to certain users. And I would like to remind these individuals or organizations, the information obtained from a company registered, no matter the method, these is personal data. If they are misused or abused, that will injure the data subject, the civil and the criminal liability will be imposed on the person who misused or misdisseminated such data. This has nothing to do with the new inspection regime. Under the existing framework, this has been provided for. We'll communicate with the PCPD on the priorities of enforcement so we can cooperate with them so that we can follow up on the data circulating online or in the public space.
Next, Mr. Chen Chung-tai. Now, in Ming Pao, there's a report today concerning there's a case of misuse of land in Park Lap. It's a piece of land that's being used and a fee is charged. Now, there's company search that showing that the land is owned by a listed company. Now, previously, it was 10 years ago, another piece of land was supposed to be used for a school, and but used for something else now. So now, actually, this kind of company search is in the public interest. It's not doxing. Now, Mr. Chen Kim Po said that now you are what made a related point, and it's clear that you are now targeting the media. Now, after this legislation is passed, and this report in the media will not appear, something like that will not appear. Now, if there is an exemption in court for the public interest, now I think that's okay. Now, the wetlands in Park Lap issue, I think that's not doxing. Now, in court, there should be room to determine whether the matter is in the public interest. So that can be a direction for the legislation. When we draw up the list of specified persons, now we certainly didn't try to target the media specifically. That was not our motive. Now, in the company's register, which the public can access, the protected information is not visible unless you are a specified person. So how can you be a specified person? I responded already, to that already. Now, there are certain legal obligations that would be the basis. If you meet those legal obligations, then you are on the list. And that's where we draw the line. Now, whether you are the media or other organization, now, that would be the general public. For us, that's the general public. Now we do not apply targeted restrictions on the media. So, now, there is a contradiction here. Now, so for specified persons, now some people do company search and they accumulate a large data bank, and then they can sell the information. Now there can be a false declaration, so you can charge the specified person. Now, for the media, there should be a defense that they are acting for public interest. That would be a buffer. So you can strike a balance that way. Now, this gives the impression that you are just targeting the media. Well, I won't repeat the discussion. I don't know whether the government read the Ming Pao report. They tell the reader that it's a company search report. Now, there are similar reports in now. Suppose someone says the source is an informed party. Now, so would you then trace the responsibility to the media that initially made the report? Let me explain a bit further. Now, in responding to Dr. Chen, I said that when we dropped the list of suicide persons, we didn't target the media. Now, in the future, when the public accesses the company's registry, now, companies register, you won't be denied the company search just because you are the media. Now, I don't know what information that Dr. Cheng is responding to, is referring to, but I don't know whether, I'm not sure whether the full ID number or the residential address is in the public interest. Now the media or anyone can conduct company search. Now, they can state whether they want to find out whether someone is a director of a company. Now, that's a motive that's allowed for company search. Now, if media wants to find out if someone is a director of a company and at the same time director of other companies, that right will not be affected in the future. Reporters can make reports that way, and they can clearly state that the information is from the company's registry. There wouldn't be any legal problem. Mr. Xu Kafai is out of the room right now. Any other person for the first round? If not, Mr. Luk Chung Hong, second round. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, the Deputy Secretary that the Labour Tribunal mediation work is not affected. Now, that's not necessarily true. Now, very often, whether it's the worker or whether it's the trade union assisting the worker, in the case when companies fold up and disappear, then we get the information by company search and we approach the Labour Department, and then the Labour Department can try to contact the company that way. Now, if we don't have the address, then only when the letter is returned, only then can the Labour Department take action, or to will the Labour, only then can the Labour Department respond. So that takes time, and in the meantime, the callous employer do something that's to get away with from his responsibility. Now, so if an address is invalid, can you reduce the time required to get the full address of the director. Now, so when if the company is already absent from, is no longer at the address, then you, why do you need to send a letter and then wait for the letter to be returned by the post office? Now, how long can the director, can the employer evade responsibility before you would take administrative action? And you know that workers are very anxious when they want to recover unpaid wages. Now, when a company goes bankrupt, there may have to be special administrative arrangements to speed up the handling. Now, that is certainly the case. Now, several departments may have to make adjustments. The labor department, the mediating team, now if the company no longer exists, but the director still uses the address as correspondence address, then yes, there may be room to speed up the administrative process in that case. So we have to give administrative justice for the person concerned. Now, the law doesn't state how much time is allowed for the person to make clarification. I think there is room to reduce the time for determining that the address is no longer valid. Now, Mr. Luk Chung Hong is concerned about the timing, the urgency of the matter, and I think we can give priority on that basis. Now, whether it's the mediation process or finding ways to communicate in respect of company's registry, I think we can find ways and means. Michael Chen, I'm sorry, I just went to the housing panel. How about now, same name, different persons? Can I come to that? Sure. Now, okay, suppose there are two Chen Tai men. Now, the ID number is the same, so can we understand that? How can we determine whether it's the same person? Now, after the new arrangement is effective. Now, the partial ID number is the same. Now, the first alphabet and the first three digits after that are the same, and it's the same person. Now, but different persons, then our system does show it's the different person, and then we will show one more digit in the system, and that will distinguish between the two persons. That can be the fourth or the fifth or the sixth digit, depending on which digit that can make the distinction. But we do not indicate the entire ID number. So initially it's A123, if it's the same, then you, and if one other digit is the same, then you find a digit that's different. So you know that these are two different persons, but you don't show the full ID numbers. Yes, correct. Now,
well, just now Mr. Chen asked why these measures weren't mentioned in the brief. On 5A and B, we outlined the administrative measures. However, we did not elaborate how it actually works. Thus, the members may not be aware of how these procedures are worked out. However, 5A and B handle situation of a same identical full name and partial IDN. There were measures in place to facilitate the public. The second question of same name and different person. Well, the ID would is the same, you have no choice. Well, for artificial man-made error, I see they have some good proposal. You have done so much. Instead of going to the fullest to amend the law so not to forbid anyone that must use their ID to register as a company director, will you not take this step or not taking this step? Mr. Hui, there's two part in this. Just now, the chairman did explain there's a legacy issue to deal with. Well, for the same person with different names, we see most cases these are mostly clerical errors. Sometimes the agent failed to verify when they filed the applications. Well, I hope that they can correct themselves for some future submissions. As for whether we need to prescribe by law more clearly, we not rule out such possibility. For this round of commencement notice, as they are subsidiary legislation, we do not touch on the main legislation. If we have a chance in the future, we will enhance their provisions so that the company register will become more reliable and accurate. It is something we'll look into. Next, Mr. Felix Chung, first round. A question for DS. Well, I know there are exemptions to professional bodies or professionals to gain full access of the register. For others, members of the public, and for the media, if they have sufficient grounds to prove they need access to such information for matter of public interest, will you provide for a mechanism for them to apply access? Under the main provisions of the CO, well, a person has a sufficient interest can apply through the court of first instance to order for the full disclosure of company director particulars, including their URAs and full IDN. However, this provision is not intended to address the situations in Mr. Chung's inquiry, that the underlying grounds might not have to do with the public interest. Well, in litigation, the legal parties may see their legal proceeding being jeopardized due to the loss of personal particulars, then the person with sufficient interest can apply to access such information. However, in the main legislation, it did not specify that public interest is a ground to access sensitive information of directors. As for whether we need to take this factor into account, we won't rule that out. Under the current main legislation, this is not mentioned. And on the subsidiary legislation, we cannot create a new category that did not exist in the main legislation. Therefore, we're not able to entertain Mr. Cheung's proposal. Well, however, as a policy proposal, we'll take that to record, and hopefully we can revisit the need to include this in the main legislation. Next, Dr. Cheung, second round. I would like to follow on Mr. Look's question on the considerations. In case of labor dispute, from the employee's perspective, when they need to file a civil claim, they will face the limitations proposed by the new regime, even though you mentioned the Labor Department will have a role. However, the Labor Department is not responsible for conducting inspections. Well, I might agree with the direction. However, this IC may be the only way to resolve this problem. You can authorize a certain government department to handle such kind of inspection requests. I see that as quite direct. So long as you get a confirmation from the Labor Department that the inspection is solely for the purpose on an insolvency case or a labor dispute or an occupation injury case to file a civil claim. With this proof, why could not offer this exemption within the class specified persons? While the employees are already disadvantaged, then I actually need to engage a lawyer to conduct inspection, which will charge me a fee. It shouldn't be the way it works. While there are no legal representation at the small claims, however, we should not let the lawyers make money that way. Well, that's also related to Mr. Christopher Cheung's question. How can a group of specified person with access to such data what can turn into money? Then you might question them whether it breached the PDPO. That why are you refuse to grant power to the Labor Department? Well, just like the powers under 5-9, kept 5-9, why are you reluctant to consider along those lines? Mr. Sam Hui, thank you, Dr. Cheung's suggestions. Well, let me illustrate for different scenarios in a labor dispute. When a labor dispute broke out, the primary role of the Labor Department would try to mediate both sides. In the course of mediation, the Labor Department, as public officers, they do have the right to access sensitive data without additional authorization required. From the Labor Department experience, it is very rare to invoke such powers. At a labor dispute, the employee is the company. Well, very often the claims are filed against a company instead of the directors themselves. Therefore, they do not need to access the sensitive info of directors. While the Labor Department aware of this new regime in very exceptional circumstances, whereas the employer had unreasonably compromised the interests of the workers. And in this case, the sensitive particulars of the director is directly relevant to the claim. The Labor Department will invoke his or her power to help complete the mediation process. Dr. Cheng also mentioned that in the course of litigation, there are two scenarios. First, labor tribunal hearing. This is a streamlined process without legal representation. And on the employee is usually a company instead of a director. At the labor tribunal, even though the staff side access the residential address of the director, this would not help the hearing at the labor tribunal stage, as this is relevant. And another scenario is that civil proceedings is initiated. For civil proceedings, whether through pro bono lawyers or other kind of arrangements, that both parties will be represented legally. A legal representative deal with court work as part of their professional work, and this is actually covered under the proposed specified persons. While to help their clients, the lawyers, in order to help to do a statutory procedure, they can access the personal info of the directors. So these all have been catered to. Yes, I'm clear about the categorization. Like Mr. Luke said, at the civil claims stage, well, we need to pay extra to engage the lawyers, which place burden on the workers. I don't understand it. Why don't you provide such a buffer? Well, for the specified persons, why some sectors, of course, this is requisite of the sector. Refer to my first question. Well, considering from the press perspective, they will see that why do other sectors are given privileges? I don't have any questions. Mr. Hui, well, you seem to reiterate the same viewpoint to Mr. Chung and Dr. Cheng. Any other members having questions? If not, we have completed the discussion, the policy matters. And we now proceed to examine the provisions of the 7 pieces of subsidiary legislation. Let's refer to the LN 95 to LN 101, and also the markup copy provided by the LSD, which is LC CB1 107/2021-01, and the letter from the Assistant Legal Advisor to the Administration, LC paper number CB1 107/2021-03. We first start with a Chinese version and let's follow by the number. Let's start with LN95. I'll ask my colleague, Mr. Desmond Wood, to explain. To tie in with the new inspection regime, we need to annex some piece of subsidiary legislation. The first piece is this ordinance commencement notice. And as for the section 63(1)(a)(ii)(2)(b)(3)(b) and so far, it relates to a corresponding address. And for section 643(5), stipulates that the corresponding addresses might not be a postal box. As with section 657G, authorize the financial secretary to draw regulation to specified companies to enact the masking of the full IDNs and URA. The details will be further explained in this same legislation. The second will it's the company ordinance commencement number 2, notice 2021, that by on October 22nd, the following provisions will be enacted. And for 53 also provides for the definition, and for 54 stipulated that the company registrar and for cannot provide the full IDN and URA for the public inspection. And for the case of invalid corresponding address, that when the registrar asked for a reply but did not receive them, and providing the URA for public inspection. For 56, to supplement these implementation details of Section 55, that the company registrar if no longer made available URA to the public, the companies must also show in their own register that the URA for public inspection.
Number 57 says that the director, unless under 58 to 59, the protected information cannot be used. Number 58 says that the director, in fulfilling his responsibility, can provide the protected information, that is the full URA and the IDN for specified persons. The financial secretary has set the rules to govern that, and that's in the fourth piece of subsidiary legislation. Number 59 says that the court can when the document can is not successful in providing information, the director can disclose information. Now, the creditor and the court of first instance can make the and also there are companies legislation items which say that local companies and non-local companies where the companies usual address is disclosed, and if there is any change, the director's correspondence address is changed, and then what would happen. Now, the other pieces says that the company's registry in respect of local and non-local companies. Now, the directors and residential address and full IDNs will be replaced by correspondence address and partial IDNs. And then also when local companies can supply the information, can provide the correspondence address. And full URA and full IDNs do not no longer have to be supplied to the CR. And starting and section 47-49, the persons can raised to the company's registry, that is where document is submitted, where there is full URA and full IDN, that can be blotted out. And then except under 51 and 55 specified situations, the protected information cannot be used. Number 51 says that when the specified persons apply, make application, the URA can and ID numbers can be supplied. The financial secretary can make regulations, and that will be under the fourth piece of subsidiary legislation. And then the court of first instance can supply the information to the public under certain conditions. Now, this is this can apply where the in respect of creditors, and Houghton Chow. Now, the reading, officer has been reading very quickly, so maybe I can ask the question now. Now I heard that the CFI, when according to, if some notice is issued according to the correspondence address, if the address is believed to be invalid, then the court can order the address to be resubmitted to be. Now, when law firms issue notices, now if the notice is issued to the usually known address of the person, now if within a specified time there is no response, then the notice is deemed to be received. Now, just now it said that the CFI, when the address is found to be invalid, then an order can be made for the amendment. Now, how does this work? Now, if the letter or notice is sent and there is no response, then it's deemed to be received. So I'd like to get some explanations, because this has been read rather quickly. So I'd like to get some clarification. Now, my colleague was talking about the company's ordinance, principal legislation. Now, so this is these are already existing provisions. So this is not a new provision. That Mr. Chow's question is correct. Now, under the legal procedure, if the parties in the court case, now if the correspondence address is valid, then as long as the document is served, then the process would is deemed to be complete. Now, in this part of the CO, then now, perhaps not within the court procedure, it's found that the correspondence address of the director is invalid, then there's an additional procedure. Then the creditor or other interested person can make application to court, and if the court is convinced that the means of contact is not valid, then the court can order the director of the company's registry to make to try to get an amendment. Now, if the document is effectively served, then the process would be complete. Yes, when I was working in the law firm, now the principle is very clear: as long as the notice is served, the process is complete. Then the person cannot say he hasn't received it. Now, this is very important, especially for our TV audience. So this legal principle is not affected. Perhaps your colleague can slow down a bit. I beg your pardon. The PS, please continue. Now, the fourth piece of subsidiary legislation is regarding the that the fact that the person can fail to stop supplying certain information, and then in phase under phase 2 or phase 3, so the commencement date is specified, and in part 2, now if under CO section 49 after phase 3 is effective, then the company can apply to the CR that for the full URA and IDN to be partly obscured, and part 3 says that in phase 3, that is after December 2023, the specified person can get the information and stating the purpose of the information requested. The specified persons, including the data subject or his authorized person, public officers, lawyers, practicing accountants, financial institutions, and so on. Now, the specified persons include some trustees, the inspectors, us, and the recognized change company by section 1 or part 1 of schedule 1 to the Securities and Futures Ordinance, a recognized exchange controller as defined by section 1 of part 1 of schedule 1 to the SFO. Now, the information would be used only for that purpose. Part 4, now on this piece of substitution, on last Friday I sent an email for clarification. Now that is the CB1 1077 2021-03. Now the director can ask for additional information. Now the administration explained about specified persons. Now after the written response is available, then I will further follow up with the matter. Now, so please supply the information required. PAS, please resume. Now, the part 4 says that after phase 2 is in effect, the specified person can ask for the protected information now, so it's the same specified persons. and the specified persons have to confirm the purpose of getting the information. Part 5 specifies that in certain categories of specified persons, when they get this information, they have to pay certain fees. Now, which are the specified persons involved? Now, so that's the contents of the fourth piece of subsidiary legislation. And then part 5.
And the fifth piece of legislation. The Company Records Inspection and Provision of Copies Amendment Regulation 2021. That stipulated the commencement date that for the 682G at the first phase on August 23rd this year. The third part of this bill that there will be a new division under 626I. The not producing the pass IDN and the URA, even though they have amassed the full IDN, they need to provide the first digits for public inspection. Take the Hong ID example, there will be the first, the English alphabet and the first three digits. So that's the fifth legislation. And that is the amending the Companies, Non-Hong Kong Companies Amendment Regulation 2021. And the regulation comes into operation on the day in which 54 Section 2 of the Companies Ordinance comes to operation, which is the Phase 2 date. And currently under 622J, the Non-Hong Kong Companies, when file an application, they must list out the corresponding address of the directors. And the Section 4 amend the Section 9 that the annual returns of the non-Hong Kong companies, they don't need to provide the URA and the full IDN. The seventh piece of legislation is a transitional provisions that they have been enacted in 2012, and now that we need to reenact it in light of the new inspection regime. The first part is the commencement, and for 3(1), in light of a Schedule 11 Part 2 and after Section 2, on the commencement of 53 and 59, that the company registrar must record the address and also the main operating address as the corresponding address of a director and a reserve director until these two update their corresponding addresses. And for 3(2), repeal Section 115 to tie with the phase implementation, reestablish 115A. The 115A is stipulated that by August 23rd this year, at the commencement of phase one, a company not required immediately to carry the URA and IDN of the company director until after commencement of phase two. When they first submit the first annual return, if the company after phase one, they can carry the corresponding address of their directors, whereas the corresponding address is not the registered offered address. At phase two, 24th of October 2022, and according to the requirements, they must notify the company ordinance. So that is the contents of the seven piece of subsidiary legislation. Legal advisor has a question. As for LN 992101, in terms of, I have some questions on the government on the drafting and the policy matters. Subject to the administration response, I will see you will need to report to the members. Do you have any questions in regard to the Chinese version of the legislation? As the legal advisor said, she needs to wait for the administration response before giving her opinion. And so the English version has already been sent to the administration? Yes. I have no other opinion. Let's wait for the administration. May I ask members, do we need to invite public deputations? Well, due to the pandemic, we shall invite written submissions. So we all agree? Let's invite the public to provide written submissions on the 7 pieces of legislation. That the subcommittee had received a submission by the Office of the Privacy Commissioner, which has been tabled to you. We shall need to extend the scrutiny period. We shall complete the scrutiny of this legislation. The legal advisor claims she shall wait for the administration reply to see if they have a follow-up. That the scrutiny period shall expire on the council meeting on 14th of July. We all agree that at the council meeting on 14th of July, I shall move a motion to extend the scrutiny period to the council meeting on 18th of August. If the period is extended, members may wish to note the following timetable. That the expire the scrutiny period, August 18, 2021. However, we hope to report to the House Committee on July 16. And the deadline for giving notice for amendment is 11 August 2021. As per tradition, it's normal practice for the subcommittee to report its deliberations to the House Committee before the expiry of the deadline for giving notice of motion to amend the subsidiary legislation. As the deadline for giving notice is 11 of August, that the last House Committee meeting which the subcommittee can report is deliberation of 16th July 2021. If all agree, I'll make all report on 16th of July. And for the next meeting, whether we need one, I was discussing with the clerk, we will notify the members, Mr. Holden Chow. And thank you, Chairman. I just had one point to make. After sitting in for the meeting, as for the CR will be rigorously enforced a new inspection regime to make sure that the director's names align with their ID number. I hope that you can enunciate this at the resumption of second reading at the council. Today, DS explained very clearly, for the same individual may, due to various reasons, filed different names. Well, same person, different names. For future practice, you will group them together for easy identification. Even though it is not written in the legislations, I hope that you can make it clear in your second reading speech, as you need to tell the public of the policy intent. That will help to resolve or clean up a lot of misunderstanding. Well, if we can explain it at the council, that will pretty much address most of the problems. I hope that you can make a point at the second reading speech. I found this quite reasonable as well. I hope that the Mr. Hui can take this to the Bureau. So at the resumption of the second reading, the secretary can take on board views from members. For example, Mr. Tian, or some points that weren't mentioned in the paper, but explained clearly today. I hope that these observations can be revisited in the secretary's speech at the council. Thank you for the chairman's and members' views. Well, this is a negative vetting, thus we may not have a chance for a second reading. And we noted members' views. We can consider whether we can provide in writing to respond to members' concerns for public knowledge, that behind this new inspection regime, there are also administrative measures in place. Let's say Mr. Chow's and my speech shall convey what the administration had promised at today's meeting. Any further questions? If not, that's the end of today's meeting, and thank you for coming.